Thank you very much for the invitation. It's special for me to be able to talk about this subject in Montevideo. The C2 Magnes conjecture for surfaces. Let's see the setting. M is a closed without boundary Riemannian manifold. And a Tonelli Lagrangian is a C2 function defined on the tangent bundle, such that on the fibers it is convex, means the second derivative is positive definite, and superlinear. It grows more than any linear map. The action of a curve, no, given a C1 curve, say, on the manifold, the action is the integral of the velocity vector of the curve. The curves which locally minimize the action satisfy the Euler-Lagrange equation. The Euler-Lagrange equation is a second order differential equation. So the initial conditions are given by by the velocity vector. So second order differential equation, two initial conditions is the position and velocity. So the Euler-Lagrange equation defines a flow on the tangent bundle. No? And the so you will thank this. Do you hear me better? Poco más. No?
Yeah.
Yeah. So the a way to look at the flow is take a initial an initial condition, which is a tangent vector, then solve the Euler-Lagrange equation with that initial condition, and at time t the flow gives the tangent vector of the curve at time t. It's like the geodesic flow. In fact, the geodesic flow is one example of Lagrangian systems. So examples of Lagrangian systems are the geodesic flow, for which the Lagrangian is given by the velocity square or the kinetic energy, the mass is one. Another example is the classical mechanics Lagrangian, which is given by kinetic energy minus potential energy, which is this Riemannian Lagrangian minus potential energy, which is a function which only depends on the position. And the Euler-Lagrange equation in this case is Newton's second law. No? Force is equal to mass times acceleration. Another example, there is a Magnes example in which any vector field can be embedded inside a Lagrangian system. But a Lagrangian system whose phase space is of the dimension double of the vector field. But I wanted to talk about classical mechanics because we are going to talk about perturbations a la Magne. So Magne's genericity for Lagrangian system means that we can perturb a Lagrangian, but only by adding potentials. So a property for Lagrangian systems is Magne's generic. If any Lagrangian, given any Tonelli Lagrangian, there is a generic set of functions defined on M such that the property holds for the Lagrangian when we add this new potential. So in the case of classical mechanics, that corresponds to perturbing the potential energy, but not perturbing Newton's law. So it is natural in that sense, no? Because a general perturbation of the Lagrangian would involve both x and v. This is the same kind of difficulty when one has to perturb geodesic flows. And it is any perturbation cannot be local in the phase space xv, no? Because a small perturbation in the variable x corresponds to a tube, no? Perturbs all the fibers v. So the perturbation is never local. In particular, that's the reason that we don't have a closing lemma for Lagrangian systems. No, because all the proofs of closing lemmas are made with local perturbation. Okay. besides that, the difficulty of perturbing by a potential or perturbing a Riemannian metric are more or less the same, just technical things. Okay. the action of a invariant measure. If one has an invariant probability for the Euler Lagrange flow, which lives in the tangent bundle, the action is the integral of the Lagrangian on the probability. And we will look for measures which minimize the action, minimizing measures. The Magne's conjecture is given, no, it's this Magne's genericity thing. Given a Tonelli Lagrangian, there is a generic set of potentials in CK, if we are talking about CK topology, such that given a potential in this generic set, the Lagrangian perturbed by the potential L plus phi has a unique minimizing measure which is supported on a hyperbolic periodic orbit or a hyperbolic singularity. Magne used to say that conjecture is for free, so he would put CK or C infinity freely in the conjecture. We can prove it only in the C2 topology. C2 topology, if you see the Euler-Lagrange equation, let's see. The Euler-Lagrange equation depends on the derivatives of the Lagrangian. So the vector field for the Euler-Lagrange flow is written in terms of the derivative of the Lagrangian. So perturbing C2 the Lagrangian corresponds to C1 perturbations of the vector field. So we are going to use arguments resembling some closing lemmas, C1 closing lemmas. Okay. So reductions, no? The main two reductions here are the uniqueness and the hyperbolicity of the periodic orbit. First, Magnier proved that the C infinity generically, Magnier's generically, the minimizing measure is unique. And then Magnier stated, and then we gave a proof that if the minimizing measure is supported on a periodic orbit, then generically is a hyperbolic periodic orbit. One expects that generically minimizing things are hyperbolic. Okay, and then the Magnier's characterization of minimizing measures. Yesterday was called the revelation theorem. will be the following. An invariant measure is minimizing if and only if it is supported in the Aubry set. We will say afterwards what the Aubry set is. the name comes from Fatih. There is an inclusion of several invariant sets. One is called the Magnier set. One is the Aubry set, a matter set, the support of minimizing measures. And if you see the inclusions, the names are chosen such that if you see the inclusions, the word Magnier appears. Okay. The set of Tonelli-Lagrangians, which has a unique hyperbolic periodic orbit is open. Semi-continuity of the minimizing measure and the and the fact that the hyperbolic things are open. So Magnier's conjecture becomes reduced to proving the following: that densely in the Aubry set contains a periodic orbit or a singularity. So we will not deal with the singularity because we just say if there is a singularity, it will be in the in the Aubry set. It will be hyperbolic, but same things. And then that's one of the cases in the conclusion. So we discard that case and look for the periodic orbit in the other case. Mm-hmm. So I have to define the Aubry set. We start by talking about the Magnier's critical value. So the Magnier potential, given the two points on M, we want to look at the minimal action of going from x to y. What may happen is that if we have a a closed curve which has a action which is negative. Then what we can do is, if we want to minimize the action from x to y, is go from x to the closed curve, go around it infinitely many times, and then come back to y. Huh? Or and then the action will be many times this negative number. So the infimum will be minus infinity. So that magnetic potential will be minus infinity in that case. So in order to avoid that, we add a constant k to the potential, to the Lagrangian, in such a way that every closed curve has a non-negative action. The minimal k for which that holds, that will imply that the Magnier potential is finite. So the minimal k that we add to the Lagrangian so that the Magnier potential is finite is called Magnier's critical value. It has many characterizations. One of them is Magnier's ergodic characterization of the critical value, which is given by the negative of the minimal action among minimizing measures. Mm-hmm. So in particular, if mu is an invariant measure, the integral is larger than or equal to zero, and it is zero only if it is minimizing. Okay, a curve is semi-static if it is a free time minimizer. So given two points in the curve, the Magnier potential, the minimal action between those two points, is attained by the curve. Okay, a free time minimizer. And in the pendulum, the semi-statics are the solutions which start at the fixed point, at the upper fixed point, and go and end in the fixed point, in infinite time. That's why I think Magnier called them semi-static. And a curve is static if the following is satisfied. First, it is semi-static, a free time minimizer. And second, the Magnier potential among points in the curve satisfies the following: going from one point to the other, that's the action, the minimal action of the curve, plus coming back gives zero action. So So we have the curve is a free time minimizer, and the action of going from here to here along the curve, or the minimal action plus the minimal action of coming back is zero. Perhaps this coming back is not realized by any curve. Could be something like, usually something like this, say, here we have and another one semi-static going to the right and another semi-static coming back. All free time minimizers. If the total action is zero, then they are in the Obreset, we say. And the Obreset contains, in this case, the red ones and the blue and green. So that is our well, that was this, no? So the sets, no? The Magnier set is called is a set of tangent vectors to semistatic orbits, tangent vectors to free time minimizers, and the Obreset set is the tangent vectors to static orbits, no? The ones which are free time minimizers, and also the action of coming back gives zero. Well, and I said this Obreset set satisfies the fact that if an invariant measure is an invariant measure is minimizing if and only if it is supported on the Obreset set. Yes. That also happens with the Magnier set, which is larger, because everything which is recurrent on the Magnier set is in the Obreset set. Because the potential of going from one point to itself is zero. So if you have something which is recurrent and realizes the potential, realize this zero. Okay. So our theorem will be the following. We have a closed manifold and a Tonelli Lagrangian. And the Obreset set is hyperbolic, and suppose that the Obreset set is hyperbolic and without singularities. Then we can perturb it a la Magnier in the C2 topology, such that the Obreset set contains a periodic orbit. If the Obreset set contains a periodic orbit, then there is a minimizing measure supported on the periodic orbit. And then. So that is what we have to prove. The corollary is that if we talk about the set of Lagrangians, no, or potentials for which the Obreset set is hyperbolic, that's H, and we define P as a set of potentials for which the Obreset set is a hyperbolic periodic orbit, then this, to be a hyperbolic periodic orbit, is open and dense in the set of Lagrangians, which are hyperbolic. So this is a Magnier's conjecture restricted to hyperbolic Aubry sets. Okay, but luckily we have another theorem which says that if M is a surface, this is why we restrict the conjecture to surfaces. If M is a surface, then to have a hyperbolic Aubry set is open and dense in the C2 topology, made by Figali, Rifor, and Contreras. this was done by using the theory developed by Figali and Rifor about perturbations of Aubry sets, and a theory of Hamiltonian points without conjugate points, developed by several people and inspired by the people in gray. So as a corollary, we don't have to restrict ourselves to hyperbolic Aubry sets because they are already generic in the case of surfaces. We obtain the Magnier's conjecture in C2 topology on surfaces. The set of potential for which the Aubry set is a hyperbolic periodic orbit is open and dense in the C2 topology, surfaces. Remarks, the proof uses our ideas of a... you can write the same problem for functions on the shift, say, in symbolic dynamics. You want to minimize or maximize the action, the integral of a function on a the integral by invariant measures of a function on a shift. And that subject is called ergodic optimization, which started as a baby version of Magnier's problem. and that could be solved. I mean, we could prove that generically on the function which you are integrating in Lipschitz topology, the minimizing measure is supported on a periodic orbit, and that this work is that those arguments can be translated to a Lagrangian setting. The proof in the case of ergodic optimization, and here as well, because here is a rewriting of that proof for Lagrangians, relies on work of several people which approached the conjecture and proved approximations to the conjecture, and we used all those approximations and give the final remark. So there are Joan, Hunt, Bressot, Quas, Sifkin, and Morris. And then symbolic dynamics corresponds to hyperbolic Aubry sets. That's why we use this theorem with the Figali and Rifo. So steps of the proof. There are two main steps of the proof. First, we prove that generically, that's in the CK topology, the Aubry set has zero entropy, zero topological entropy. And the second step is knowing that the Aubry set has zero topological entropy, how to obtain this closed periodic orbit in the Aubry set. So the first step, no, to have zero topological entropy is done in the following way. First, one obtains a closed orbit nearby the Aubry set with a period which is not too large. Those are the estimates. No? The action can be compared with the distance to the Aubry set, and that is decreases super exponentially on M, and M is comparable to the logarithm of time. The way it is done is something like this. You have the Aubry set and take something like a T delta generating set or something like 2T generating set on the Aubry set. So that this the dynamic balls of time 2T cover all the Aubry set, and then make a subset of finite type in the following way. We can follow one from one point we can follow to another point if they are shadowed for a time t. So so that makes that these pieces of orbits are all in the Aubry set and are very near to each other because they are shadowed by time t and this thing is hyperbolic. And then we have a projection from the shift defined like this to a neighborhood of the Aubry set by shadowing. No? We have a sequence of points, and then this is a hyperbolic set, and then we obtain a curve which shadows the the sequence of points. That curve will not be in the Aubry set, but will be very nearby. And how nearby it is because this shadow. So, and then use the arguments for the shift. In the shift, one takes a a closed orbit with the minimal period, and that will satisfy these estimates. So that was made for shifts originally by Bressot and Quas, and Anthony Quas. They were trying to approach the conjecture. So they couldn't obtain a periodic orbit generically, but they said how a minimizing measure is approached by periodic orbits, no? By measures on periodic orbits, and this was. And then we use the arguments of Morris, made also in the ergodic optimization case, to prove that the entropy is generically zero. And it is done in the following way. You have this close orbit with small period. It is very near the Aubry set, so it inherits the Aubry set is a is a graph, is a Lipschitz graph over the manifold. So since this periodic orbit is very near to the Aubry set, it inherits part of the graph property. Okay. So suppose it is a graph, and then put a potential which is like a half a channel around this periodic orbit. That makes that for nearby potentials, the minimizing measures will be in this tunnel. Half pipe. So we have this closed curve, and we put a potential which is like this, small. And then since this was a minimum, okay. And then we make estimates in such a way that the new Aubry set is, or the new minimizing measures are have to be in the neighborhood of this periodic orbit, and then in a neighborhood, a small neighborhood, and those are the estimates, no, of a periodic orbit. Something cannot have large entropy, no? Because I mean, you have a periodic orbit, and then in the neighborhood you can have a horseshoe, but the horseshoe appears after the period, so it is it has small entropy. You calculate how much of the measure has to be in the neighborhood with the small entropy, and how much of the measure is outside. And okay, that is the argument. The second part is knowing that the Aubry set has zero entropy, how to close the Aubry set, how to obtain a periodic orbit. let's see. That again has two parts. One, which was known for shifts, I will tell, and the new part is this second, using the zero entropy. Okay. So we will perturb a return. If we have special returns inside the Aubry set, we can perturb it to obtain a new Aubry set with a periodic orbit. The special returns we are going to use so it's a situation similar but not equal to to a closing lemma. If we have the following situation, we have an orbit in the debris set, a piece of orbit, which returns at a distance delta, and which the minimal distance among pieces of the orbit, well, the minimal, say here, is called gamma. And suppose that we have this situation in which so many of these ones in which this quotient is tending to zero. So the distance here with respect to the minimal distance in the middle, it tends to zero. If we have this situation, then we can obtain a periodic orbit set, which is a periodic orbit. In fact, we will do something a little different from this. Instead of one of one return, we will allow to have instead of an orbit, a pseudo orbit, so we can jump. And we will do it for two jumps. So instead of an orbit, a pseudo orbit, with at most two jumps. Okay. So we need to obtain this situation. Returns, no? With arbitrarily small distance to return, but in the middle the orbit cannot approach too much. So the sketch of the proof that that this is enough to to obtain a periodic orbit. No, not much time. I will jump to the other part, which is how to obtain this situation. This is the sketch of the proof of why this situation is enough. Okay. Okay. So suppose that we have already orbits. No, we have to prove why we always have orbits which have this behavior. No, situation where we can perturb, and we do an argument which is inspired in part of, it's not the same, but it is inspired in part of Magnier's conjecture. I'm sorry, in parts of the proof of the stability conjecture by Magnier, which was Magnier was trying to find homoclinic connection, and then he would say something like this: if you have a hyperbolic periodic orbit and you have invariant measures such that they in the limit the measure of this point is positive. So invariant measures which accumulate here, then you can perturb to obtain a homoclinic trajectory. And the and the method was by contradiction. Suppose I cannot perturb, then if I cannot perturb, then the measure should give a lot of weight outside, and then the limiting weight of this is cannot be positive. So in our case, no, we want to obtain this situation, and by contradiction, suppose that we never obtain this situation. Then the proposition is the following: if we take a minimizing measure, an ergodic minimizing measure, and a generic point for the ergodic minimizing measure, and a transversal section, and we look at the return times to the transversal section, then then they last this amount of time between one and the following, and then we calculate the entropy nearby the point using the Brinkatox theorem. The measure of a small ball around this point is given by how many returns I have to the transversal section. No? And if the return lasts a lot of time, then the measure of the transversal section has to be small, because no, it is an invariant measure. The measure has to be spread over the orbit. And then the measure will be shrinking exponentially, no? With time, and hence by Brinkatox theorem, the entropy would be positive, and it was zero by hypothesis. So how do we prove this this proposition that I'm sorry, that the return times last a lot? The argument is as follows. I will write the pseudo orbit as a circle, say this is so I start here and then come back, it's a pseudo orbit. And so suppose that I cannot have this situation. So in the middle, there should be a return. Hmm? Okay, it's, I should have let's see if I... I need to discretize So I have a return, and it does not hold the condition. So say gamma one would be larger than something like. Yes, smaller than. So, since it does not satisfy the condition, there is a point in the middle, no, a return, which which is a small. And then we split this in two pseudo-orbits. No? So the return is small, so I can do the following. I start here, and then jump here. And that will be a new pseudo-orbit with two jumps. And the red one will be another pseudo-orbit with two jumps. That corresponds to going here, jump, and then come back. And then this is a new pseudo-orbit. But then these two pseudo-orbits are in the same I mean they could be used to obtain the theorem. By contradiction, we are saying that we cannot. Then there must be two returns here. Of the next order, so this one was a smaller return, and then there will be another order next return, and then these ones are pseudo orbits with two jumps, and then the argument repeats. No? The quantity, there should be a returns here. And probably here. So if we see the quantity of returns is growing exponentially. So that means that the quantity of points in the pseudo orbit is exponentially large. So the original return lasted an exponentially large time. There is one thing that the exponential growth can only be proven for the second iterate, and that is the, then we have to look at all the possibilities. There are not many. That's why I talked only about two jumps, because for example, this one, here we have one jump, another jump, and a third jump. So this one, I will not count, will stop there. because the combinatorics gets too large, so I would continue only here, and then but I am sure that after two iterations, I get the doubling of the quantity of returns, and that is the that is the reason of this that the exponential is not 2 to the something but the square root of 2. Okay, thank you very much. Yes, the hyperbolicity in the second step is more important. So you have this situation, and then the first thing is you close the orbit using the shadowing lemma. No? Then you have to prove that this orbit can be made. One can make the Obrist set to be this orbit, and it is done as follows. First, it also inherits some graph properties. So you put a potential which is a half pipe around it. And then I have to prove that for this new Lagrangian, the Obrist set is the periodic orbit. It is done as follows. We will prove that any semi-static orbit, which is defined in the past, will have a semi-static. Then the alpha limit is in the closed orbit. That will imply, because alpha limits of semi-statics are in the Obrist set, that will imply that gamma is in the Obrist, and that's what we want. And how how do we do that? If So suppose that that the alpha limit of a semistatic is not inside gamma, then by the expansivity of the, no, it will perhaps it will approach gamma, but it will have to go out of gamma. It cannot be nearby gamma forever because it would be gamma, and have to go out of gamma infinitely many times. And so it have to be a little while outside of gamma infinitely many times. So each time it will be adding a positive cost in the Lagrangian. So the total action will have to be infinity. But the action of a semistatic is given by the potential, the action, the Manev potential. Manev potential is Lipschitz, and then it is bounded. So that so that situation cannot be. So after a while, it is not outside of a neighborhood of gamma, and then the alpha limit is gamma because it's also hyperbolic. So, yes. Thank you.